Seven-time Olympic gold medalist and record-breaking swimmer, 24-year-old Katie Ledecky is one of the most decorated Olympic athletes from the Tokyo Games. She won the first-ever women's 1500-meter freestyle in Tokyo, and she won gold in the 800-meter and two more silver medals in the Games, bringing her career total to 10. Katie Ledecky is here with me in our studio. And welcome and congratulations, and you're wearing four of those medals from Tokyo. Are you still on cloud nine?
I am. It's great to be back in the U.S. and to be with family and friends and to just share all the memories with them.
And they look heavy, so get right off the bat, tell us how heavy are they.
They are. Well, you felt it earlier. It's always shocking to people how heavy they are, so it's fun to bring them around to schools or just anywhere and have somebody feel how heavy they are.
So exciting what you did in Tokyo, and yet we were all conscious there was nobody there as a spectator. You were there with your coach and teammates. Did that affect what you were able to do, do you think?
Well, I think I was actually sort of surprised at how normal it did feel. I had my teammates in the stands cheering when they didn't have races or when they were done competing. So they brought a lot of energy to our team. I think Team USA was the loudest at the pool. So that was really nice to just be able to look in the stands and still see some familiar faces that are supporting you.
I'm asking because you're used to hearing cheering, screaming fans out there, you know, from one end of the pool to the other.
Yeah, I mean, it was also tough not having family there, and I made sure to video call my family in between races as best I could. I just had those short moments, and there was the time difference, but we snuck it in.
I was looking at some of what was written about your winning the 1500-meter freestyle, first time that competition's been there for women at the Olympics, and thinking 15 minutes plus of swimming your heart out, how hard is it?
It's a challenging race, but it was so great that it was finally in the Olympics. There are so many women that didn't have that opportunity, and it's been a long time coming. So for the U.S. to go 1-2 in that event for the first time it was there was incredible. It's the best we could do.
And I was also reading, Katie Ledecky, what you said about what's the secret sauce. I mean, how do you, year after year, Olympic after Olympic, keep doing what you're doing? And you came back with a very straightforward answer, and you said it's practice. And I think a lot of people would say, so hard work? How inspirational can that be?
Yeah, I mean, everyone's always trying to find out what the secret is, but there really isn't a secret. It's just a lot of hard work over many, many years, and not just from myself, but from my coaches, my teammates, my family, everyone that's helped me get to this point. It's not just the 15 minutes that I'm in that race in the 1500. It's hours and hours every week for 5 years from Rio to now, but also the many years before that.
As I know you know very well, there was a lot of attention at the Games to Simone Biles and what she said about opting out of some of the events in order to deal with her mental health. It's not something we often hear from the most successful athletes. How do you think about all that?
Yeah, well, mental health is super important, and it goes hand in hand with physical health. And we've talked a lot about health as a whole over the past year and a half. And I think it's important to continue to talk about. And athletes are humans too. We experience very similar things to everybody. And I don't think it's just an athletic problem, but you see everyone in society have different challenges, and everyone has to support each other to get to where you want to get if you have those big goals. And a lot of people do have big goals, and it takes a balanced approach to reach those goals and a lot of support. You have to rely on your support system, and it was great to see that Simone and many other athletes at the Games were able to do that successfully.
You've been doing this now for a number of years. Do you think women athletes have it tougher than men, or do you think it's pretty much evened out? What do you think?
I don't know. I think female athletes do have some challenges that men don't have, whether that's on the competition field or pool or court or outside of it. And again, just going back to the 1500, it was so great to finally get that opportunity. And I feel like swimming is a really great sport in that the men and the women compete on the same playing field. They usually alternate a men's event and a women's event, and we all train together and things like that. So I've been really grateful that in our sport, it hasn't had that big of a disparity, but I know that many athletes and female athletes do feel the need to get out there, and there are some differences that need to be addressed.
And in connection with that, we're remembering Title IX,
yes.
which, of course, was the law that was yes. passed in, 1972, almost 50
yes.
years ago, mandating that women had to be treated equally
yes.
With men in education and particularly in sports. And you've talked about that, and you've said yes. what a difference it made, but you've also said there's more work that needs to be done around that. What needs to be done, do you think?
For sure, yeah. I mean, as you said, my mom was one of the first beneficiaries of Title IX. She swam at the University of New Mexico and was able to get a scholarship and compete and get a great education. And so looking back on that, I don't know if I would have been a swimmer if my mom hadn't swum through college. And she didn't push me into the sport by any means, but she helped teach me how to swim. And I grew to love the sport, probably because of some of that love of the sport that she had. So I look at my career, and I don't know if it would have been possible without Title IX. And I'm really grateful for all of the advances we've made over the past 50 years through Title IX. And there is a lot of work to continue to be done.
And when you look at the younger athletes coming along today, whether it's women in swimming or in other sports, do they have a clear field ahead of them, or are there still obstacles out there? What do you think?
No, there are still obstacles out there. And you just look at companies, and I want to see more females in boardrooms and leading companies, especially athletic companies. And I think that's a big step that needs to be taken over the next several years. And I hope that I can lead in whatever way I can.
And speaking of the future, you mentioned this, you're already looking ahead to the Olympics in 2024. You've just graduated from Stanford University. Congratulations.
Thank you.
But you said the other day, Katie Ledecky, that you were thinking about what you wanted to do outside the pool. Tell us a little bit about that. What are you thinking?
Well, I'm passionate about a lot of things outside of the pool. I've had the great opportunity to work with Panasonic on a STEM education program where I've been able to visit schools and visit with students virtually as well over the past year, talking about the importance of education and setting goals and trying to familiarize students around the country with science, technology, engineering, and math skills that they'll need in future careers. And I'm also considering going to grad school at some point. I don't know if that'll be in the next 3 years between now and Paris, but I'm going to use the next couple of months, next couple of years to really plot that out and figure out where I feel like I can be most impactful.
I think you've got some time.
Thanks.
To figure it out. Katie Ledecky, congratulations. I know everybody joins me in congratulating you. So proud of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.